Childhood remembrances are always a drag if you're black. You always remember things like living in Woodlawn with no inside toilet. And if you become famous or something, they never talk about how happy you were to have your mother all to yourself and how good the water felt when you got your bath from one of those big tubs that folk in Chicago barbecue in. And somehow when you talk about home, it never gets across how much you understood their feelings as the whole family attended meetings about Hollydale. And even though you remember, your biographers never understand your father's pain as he sells his stock and another dream goes. And though you're poor, it isn't poverty that concerns you. And though they fought a lot, it isn't your father's drinking that makes any difference, but only that everybody is together and you and your sister have happy birthdays and very good Christmases. And I really hope no white person ever has cause to write about me, because they never understand black love is black wealth. And they'll probably talk about my hard childhood and never understand that all the while, I was quite happy.
And welcome back to English 9. That was Nikki Giovanni reading her poem, Nikki Rosa. We're going to get more into that in just a second. Before we do that, I just want to clarify a few things about this whole poetry unit we've started on. Basically, like I've said before, every other day, I'll be posting an assignment. The assignment will consist of a few things, a few steps you'll need to complete. Number one is I'm going to try and record a video lesson every day. And in that video lesson, I will introduce you to a new style of poetry, like today, catalog poems, or maybe ode poems in the future. We'll read a couple, listen to some maybe. I'll try and annotate and analyze them and show you like what I'm getting from these poems, and that's just my opinion. And then I'm going to ask you to read through some catalog poems as well. I'll post them. And then you will, in one document, write down your findings from what you got out of one of the poems I posted. So I'll like have a box and you can write down like this is what I got. And then number two, I'm going to ask you to write a poem in that same style. So if I'm asking you to write like I did before, a what is poetry poem, you write a what is poetry poem. If I'm asking you like I'm doing today to write a catalog poem, you write a catalog poem. What's a catalog poem? We'll get into that. But I just really want to stress before we get to it that this poetry unit is supposed to be kind of, you know, expression of yourself. So don't get too stressed about like, oh, my poetry's not great. Oh, it's terrible. I've already read some of your guys' poems. I love them. I've seen some of you guys commenting like, Mr. Butler, poetry's not for me. And then you write your poem. Lean into it. It won't work out maybe. It won't be the best, but don't stress too much about it. I'm just looking forward to seeing your guys' engagement and seeing what you guys can come up with. So without any further ado, let's get into it.
So what is catalog poetry? A catalog poem, there's so many things you could say about it, but it's a catalog poem brings together many different images and presents them for your attention in a poem format. You can think of a catalog poem being like a store catalog that is filled with pictures of almost anything in the world you'd want to buy, but instead it's a story or experiences. In short, it's a list of things. It can but does not have to rhyme, and it can be any length. It's a very flexible way to write a poem. It's just you sharing experiences, thoughts, memories, ideas, and then putting them together as a whole to kind of send a message. It's very free form, so you really can do anything you want with this poetry structure. There are some elements to it, though, that are interesting and worth noting. There are poetry elements that you can bring into them, however, that are frequent and found. So one of them is repetition. Repetition, of course, is just, you know, the repeating of things. So some things that could be repeated in a poem for a point are repeated words, repeated sounds. So repeated words like the same... A poem could end a sentence with the same word every time to make a point. A poem could have the same sound like ish or a or it or ack or at the end of every sentence to really make a point, to stand out. Or there could be the same letter over and over again, like several F's, several L's, etc. Or, of course, it could also be the repetition of a phrase. For one example, we could go to Kendrick Lamar's The Art of Peer Pressure, where he says... So there he uses that repeated phrase, me and the homies, to over and over again underscore what he's saying in the rest of the song to make his point. I'm not going to get into it, but he makes a point there by using that repetition of that phrase to really signal something. Also, when he repeats that, it creates rhythm. A repetition of sounds creates rhythm. So a lot of times poets will use that repetition of sounds or words or phrases, etc., to create a kind of rhythm in their poem that as you read it, you get drawn in to the message. So those are some important elements. And then a final one is the structure, how a poem is built. You might not think that a poem is built, but there are elements that a lot of times poets use. Not all poets, and again, it's very free form, but you can choose to use structure. So some things you might want to pay attention to as you're reading a poem are the punctuation. Do they have periods, commas, things like that? Capitalization. You'll notice capitalization is not capitalized. Sometimes poets capitalize words or leave capitalization off to make a point about something. Sentence length. Sometimes a line is long as well. So you wanted to look at length of sentences, lines, and that sort of thing. So structure is important to poems. And now we'll take a look at some, and hopefully you can get an idea of what that means. Okay, so welcome back. We're going to be reading Nikki Rosa by Nikki Giovanni. And then I'll annotate it, and I'll try and talk through some of the things I'm seeing from it, just to give you an example of what you could do. So before we get to doing that, I think it's important that we hear the poem again. And rather than having me read it, I think it makes more sense to have Nikki Giovanna read of herself. So without any further ado, this is Nikki Rosa by Nikki Giovanna.
Childhood remembrances are always a drag if you're black. You always remember things like living in Woodlawn with no indoor toilet. And if you become famous or something, they never talk about how happy you were to have your mother all to yourself. And how good the water felt when you got your bath from one of those big tubs that folk in Chicago barbecue in. And somehow, when you talk about home, it never gets across how much you understood their feelings as the whole family attended meetings about Hollydale. And even though you remember, your biographers never understand your father's pain as he sells his stock and another dream goes. And though you're poor, it isn't poverty that concerns you. And though they fought a lot, it isn't your father's drinking that makes any difference, but only that everybody is together. And you and your sister have happy birthdays and very good Christmases. And I really hope no white person ever has cause to write about me, because they never understand black love is black wealth. And they'll probably talk about my hard childhood and never understand that all the while, I was quite happy.
So that was Nikki Rosa. And right now we can just go through it. I'll annotate this, try and keep it quick, because I know this video is already pretty long. But if, right off the bat, something I noticed is that it says childhood remembrances, and the C is uncapitalized. So that could be an indicator from Nikki that we should be paying attention to capitalization in this poem. And the next word that is capitalized is black. So again, it seems like she's drawing attention to that experience that obviously she, as a black woman, has had. Moving on, another capitalization that we find is Woodlawn. And then just a bit later is Chicago. If you do a little bit of research on Nikki, you can quickly find out that she actually was spent a bit of time in Woodlawn, and then also at one point in Chicago. And really, these can also be taken to illustrate the entirety of the black experience, if we go back to that emphasized words. Woodlawn is from the south in Tennessee, and Chicago, of course, is in the north. So it seems like Nikki is incorporating, through her use of capitalization, the entire, or at least she's trying to speak to, the entirety of, or not the entirety, obviously, but her relation with the black community. From Woodlawn, the south, all the way to the north in Chicago. Some other things that stand out are the sentence lengths, of course. Child remembrance is always a drag, and then if you're black. So we have this very long sentence, contrast to the short one that, again, can draw emphasis to it. It can draw emphasis to that short sentence. Sorry about my terrible handwriting. You'll see how god-awful it gets. So that short sentence really draws attention to this one sentence with the, again, capitalized word here as well, which then draws further to Woodlawn and Chicago. From Woodlawn, Tennessee to Chicago, Illinois. These are childhood remembrances that you have if you're black. So what is Nikki trying to say about these childhood experiences that she's had as a black woman? Well, if you go down the way bottom, she says that some people will never understand that black love is black wealth, and they'll probably just talk about my hard childhood and never understand that all the while I was quite happy. And right here we can almost say that this is the point of the poem. She's trying to draw attention to that, yes, she had a hard childhood, she's not denying that. If you go through the rest of the poem, you actually see that she talks about how she bathed in big tubs that folks in Chicago barbecue in, so it's not a typical tub. Yes, there's no inside toilets. Yes, her father had pain. And if you actually do some research again and look up Hollydale, you'll find that her family was trying to move into a neighborhood and they were not allowed to do so because of racist practices. So she also talks about poverty as well. So yes, she is not trying to hide from the fact that yes, most people would say that she's had a hard childhood. She doesn't try to hide that. She pushes that in her poem, that racism, poverty, and things like that contributed to her childhood not being, in a lot of people's view, the greatest. But throughout the entire poem, she talks about how happy they were to have your mother, how good the water felt. The whole family attended meetings, and you were understood. Everybody is together. You have happy birthdays and very good Christmases. So there's this whole emphasis of joy throughout these experiences that most people would say are tough. And so it seems like she's trying to say that in her experience as a black woman from Woodlawn to Chicago, south to north, there's been hard times, racism, hard childhood, but through it all, she's had this joy, this happiness. And then the final thing that I would say, I think she's trying to say, is that where's this happiness come from? Again, if you go to the bottom, you see she says black love. And I think that's really the key. Being together. Love is more than one person. So you go to the poem and you all of a sudden start to see that she's constantly saying you, 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 so on and so forth throughout all this. We could just circle. I mean, I might as well, because I already started, so it's just like, you know. Actually, I don't want this video to go on too long. I'll stop. Sorry. I know this is terrible. But throughout the entire poem, she's just saying you, 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 you. She's having a conversation. Even in this poem, she's trying to have a conversation with another person, and so that togetherness, everybody is together, is represented even in the poem she's writing by the language she uses. She repeats this word, you, she's talking to somebody else, she's having this communication, and so through this use of structure, through this use of repetition, through this use of capitalization, through these highlighted events, and this major part at the end, she sends this kind of message that to me it seems like she's saying a major part of her experience as a black woman was a hard childhood. She doesn't hide from it. But more than that, that she was together with her family, with her friends, and they, through that togetherness, through this conversation, through this community, they experienced and reveled in a joy that surpassed and even transcended those hard times that they went through. They didn't erase them, but they worked through them. And so in the end, she was quite happy through everything that she went through. So that's just one perspective on Nikki Rosa by Nikki Giovanna, and I'll end that there. Okay, so before we move on and end this video though, I have one more poem for you. It's We Rule Cool by Gwendolyn Brooks, and just like last time, I think it's best if she reads it rather than me. So this is Gwendolyn Brooks reading We Real Cool.
We real cool, the pool players, seven at the golden shovel. We real cool, we left school, we lurk late, we strike straight, we sing sin, we thin gin, we jazz June, we die soon.
So that's We Real Cool by Gwendolyn Brooks. Obviously, there's a structure that right away grabs your attention. This is a shorter poem. We real cool. We left school. We, I'll circle them. We lurk late. We strike straight. We sing sin. We thin gin. We jazz June. We die soon. And there's no we at the end. She also says there's seven at the Golden Shovel, seven players. And there are, unless I got it wrong, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 we's. So it's like each of them is a representation. So again, just like with Nikki Giovanna's poem, immediately community is important. There's this sense of togetherness, this we, this community that's being represented. And throughout the poem, they're cool, they leave school, they're lurking late, they're singing sin, they're thinning their gin. These are all, especially in the era that she grew up in, Gwendolyn Brooks, these are things that you would do to, in a certain sense, defy authority. Leaving school is still something very true. Singing sin, like singing songs that people would consider bawdy, or like, you know, oh, it'd be not good for you. Thinning gin, so you're drinking gin, drinking alcohol. And then Jazz June. June is a major, especially for Gwendolyn Brooks, it's a major part of her culture because a lot of people would celebrate, a lot of black people, including Gwendolyn Brooks, would celebrate Juneteenth, which is when the Emancipation Proclamation and it reached Texas. And so June is a major month that a lot of times can represent like defying the establishment, standing up for yourself. And however, Gwendolyn Brooks grew up in the era where all these activities could easily lead to the destruction of black people. And so she's kind of like representing this in one poem where she has this community, this defiance of authority and these depressive systems that were so often frequently by Gwendolyn Brooks and others like her. And unfortunately, the reality of her experience was that this often led to their destruction, their death. Again, just one perspective on this poem. It seems like she's getting the point that she's just kind of like chronicling. This is kind of just like a chronicle of like her experience, what she sees, what she's experienced, what she's been through. And in a sense, she's remembering these people, these pool players. They're not lost history. They died soon, yes, but they're not lost. They're remembered in Gwendolyn's poem, and that's her way of perhaps preserving their identities, of remembering their rebellion, even though they're lost to history now. So, again, just another catalog poem, just lots of different ideas, thoughts, all expressed in a short way. Just another example of what you could do. So, that's it for this video. Sorry about how long it is and the camera being so stuttery. I'm not a professional at this. I hope that my analysis of these poems was sensible to you and it helps you understand maybe a bit more about what you can do with your catalog poem. So again, right now what you want to do is go to the assignment in Google Classroom, open up that document. It's called Catalog Poetry. And then what you want to do is choose one of the poems that are attached and read it. Read one of the poems, analyze one of the poems, answer the questions, and give me your findings. And then, most importantly, just, you know, write a poem. Write a catalog poetry. Write a catalog poem. Tell me about one of your experiences. Tell me what it was like growing up. Tell me maybe, like, write a catalog poetry about what it's like to not be at school. Write a catalog poetry about poem about how much you want to be back at school, right? Or just about your family, or about some experience you've had in the past, or about an identity that you have. So, looking forward to reading those poems. Again, don't stress too much. I hope you guys have an excellent day. Stay chill. Write a catalog poem. Have some fun with it.